Unicorns of Love. They've kind of thrown out the playbook a little bit when it comes to what we consider meta picks and bans, definitely in the case of Xerxes. Ivern, Rumble, and Zac hasn't even played one of those, call it, dare I say, standard champions. Do you want to predict some bans here?
Yeah, the LeBlanc will probably come out.
Okay.
Maybe say maybe a Rengar, you know, on that red side. And what else could be there? Something broken, jumps around.
I'm not sure.
Jumps the walls. Camille,
you mean Fiora?
Maybe.
Oh, yeah, Camille.
Yeah.
Camille.
Give me the blinks, you know, every time.
We'll have to wait and see. It is Unicorns.
It is the Unicorns. It's the hardest team to predict the bans on red side from.
Ding!
There we go. That's one right.
Unicorns did let Rengar through them in the past. They ran the Alulu and the Poppy and the Ivern.
Yeah, mostly the Ivern. There seems to be a tendency to keep picking that Ivern up for Xerxes, so we need to see. That's something that HTK want to get rid of, if they're comfortable playing against it, and what their priority is going to be. We've seen very often Zyra blue side bans as well, with Tahm Kench ban. It seems that HTK is planning something else. We're looking at if this is a Rengar ban, either a Kha'Zix or a Zyra early pickup here for HTK. Would be meta game, but we never know, obviously.
Bing!
Yeah, there we go.
There we go. So Unicorns maybe going a little bit more standard with their picks and bans.
I expect either Zyra here or maybe the Kha'Zix, because it has gone up in popularity and such a strong jungle pick, mostly because Jankos is such a good carry jungler and he can really snowball that pick because he's so smart where he puts his time around level 3 or 4 that sometimes he'll like not to go for the gank and then he powers through to level 6 and then he's obviously a very strong champion.
All right, should we keep the pings up? You got the Kha'Zix.
We're not going to make that annoying sound, but
where do you...
I mean, it's not where I predict, it's where the metagame has settled. Like, it's not rocket science. This is usually where people then maybe go for like Varus, Zyra, especially in the LCK. Varus has been loved on the red side. We're talking about Unicorns though, so they could kind of shake that up. I'd be surprised if they just locked the Ivern in here already. I guess they really want to match jungler in the first rotation of picks, and they don't want to leave it as third in case HTK throws a spanner into work, so that could explain the Ivern. But then you usually would expect here your favorite AD carry or support.
All right, Samux has played Caitlyn twice, Jhin twice. No Ashe or Varus as of yet, though the option is definitely available to him. Exile, of course, Ryze has been banned against him. Used that one game to last pick the Kassadin as well, worked in their favor relatively well. And it's going to be the Shen.
Oh, so that's interesting. So that means that Unicorns, they're revealing one of the good tanks top. HTK, they probably want to play a tank top with that Kha'Zix, which means if they get both pinched in terms of Nautilus and Maokai and Poppy's off the board already, they don't really have a good top lane pick yet to pick after phase 2, so they may have to change their plan here from just insta-picking the bot lane on first phase to maybe pick a top lane champion. And then they have to prioritize, what do we like more, AD carry or support? And it probably is still that Zyra. So maybe they pick Zyra either Maokai here, if they just want to play tank versus tank. And if they're fine with playing damage matchup in the top lane, they pick maybe Zyra Varus here or something.
Okay, Zyra Varus, Zyra Maokai. HTK got 15 seconds on the clock, and then we're going to start looking towards these sort of phase 2 bans and trying to get a better sense of what HTK or Unicorns want to prioritize.
It's all about kind of squeezing champion pools here at this point. Be very surprised if it's a mid lane pick. Would make very little sense here. Unless it's like the broken champions. But even then, I think very few teams end up doing this unless you really just love that Syndra.
So do you like or dislike the Syndra in the context of this pick and ban? It's allowed the Katarina near instant pick here for Exile.
Yeah, it's... I'm personally not a big fan of Katarina in general. In Europe so far, I have seen it not really work out that often. I don't think HTK would have necessarily banned it in the second phase. There's plenty of good mid laners open. I would have rather seen an AD carry pick here for Unicorns and then squeeze out the other two AD carries. If you pick Ashe and you ban like a Jhin and a Varus, then you have really good composition and it's very hard for HTK to react because they have to play Caitlyn. And Nuko and Shea have already shown that they're not that great of a bot lane, so I think Unicorns could have leveraged their bot lane advantage more in the draft. Right now, we're looking at role disparity. HTK probably gonna pincer the supports in the pick and ban phase. And our Unicorns of Love, they're obviously removing the bad matchups that they don't want to play against. Shen is not that great into Rumble. Despite it being a full damage composition, you still don't want to play against that Rumble.
Yeah, and that allows then HTK to ban out the Lulu. We have seen Hilly actually play that champion twice this split as well.
Meta-wise, you would expect Lulu and then followed up with him by the Misfortune. Something you could expect.
As was the ADC pinch here. Varus off the table, so Ashe is the last sort of top tier meta, also has been played in the past.
I mean, I don't think it's necessarily an AD pinch, because pinching implies that you pick a champion, then remove the two other best champions in that tier list, forcing basically your opponent to pick down tier. I think Unicorns don't want to play Varus themselves, and they don't want to play against it. That is more likely the case.
Well, that seems to be the last train of thought. H2K, last ban.
Wow.
Gonna be the Bard, again, targeted. Very specific. Hitting Hilly's, like, stage champion.
Yeah, and you can just see how Unicorns of Love are influencing the draft, even if they pick peculiarly, but people also ban way different against them, because almost never would you ever see a Bard ban right there. So they're targeting the player, not the meta here, because they know it doesn't apply one-to-one to Unicorns of Love.
Unicorn's going to lock in their ADC preferred. It's going to be the Jhin over the Ashe this time around. Champion pool still very severely hit, so Hillisung, where does he lean back to? 1, 2, 3 support bans from H2K.
I mean, Misfortune is still the matchup to play into Zyra. So essentially, H2K are picking themselves a comfortable matchup. Most likely they go with Ashe, but even then, Jhin is still slightly favored if you believe what Reckless says on the matchup.
And is this kind of like H2K calling Unicorn's bluff? Game one of a best of three, leave MF up, even if we think you play it,
yeah,
let's see how good you play.
It's basically asking how good is your Misfortune support. And if Unicorns don't even pick it here, well then obviously H2K have won that pick and ban mental game. This is obviously the Ashe comes out. Ashe Zyra, super standard in his meta game to pick. When in doubt, when you're one counter pick into Shen, which is the Rumble is banned, you just pick Maokai, which is the strongest of the two tanks remaining in terms of Maokai and Nautilus. So H2K really following the book. The only thing they kind of changed up is that they really prioritized Syndra as their third pick, because they really wanted a strong mid laner that Fevvun can spy a lot of control on.
And that's Syndra's got the option to do so. No Misfortune, final lock in. It's going to be the Thresh. I mean, that's got to be screaming something to H2K here.
That's disrespect. If you play Thresh into Zyra, you're going to have a bad time. If the Zyra is equal skill to the Thresh, you are going to suffer. Every time you try and place a hook, she can literally just plant, spawn a plant in front of you, and the hook will just hit the plant. That's how like the game works. You simply can't outpace that. So you need to go for like flash plays, flash E ignite, but that is almost never going to guarantee any kill. We saw Ignar do it, but that was because Yharnam was, as the Europeans like to say, just trolling.
Yeah, just trolling. We'll find out whether or not Che has got that seed mechanics on wrap, and maybe the Ivern can help out, maybe.
Yeah.
Give that a little bit of extra sort of gap closer to Hillisang's Thresh. But the Gauntlet's thrown.
Yeah.
This is just Zyra v Thresh, mechanics versus mechanics. Let's see if Hilly can step up to the plate.
Oh, he has to. When you play Thresh like this, you need to make something happen, especially if you look at the composition. Very low damage on the side of Unicorns. They need to snowball from mid.
Yeah, absolutely need to. So a lot of pressure on Exile on that Katarina matchup. It is going to be going up against...
Syndra.
Thank you very much, Syndra. I was waiting for it to pop up. Thank you very much. Anyways, picks and bans are locked in. Let's get into our match of the week. It's H2K versus the Unicorns of Love.
I don't think they are as strong as last split, so I think we have a really good chance to go first seed in the group.
I do believe that your lineup got stronger this year.
Welcome back to the Spring Split, the European LCS H2K on the blue side, led by the returning mid laner Febivan Syndra. On the other side of the rift, the Unicorns of Love. Let's see what they can do with Katarina being controlled by Exile.
Yeah.
We've touched a lot on that support matchup, Crapo, but what about the rest of the map? It's only really the Ivern that's going to throw a spanner in the works here.
Yeah, the Ivern's really interesting. We saw Jankos play against it last week as well, and he was dealing very well with the pathing, keeping up, not getting kind of out mind gate or cheesed, call it what you want. Ivern has kind of two standard paths. He can either go for an invade heavy path, or he rushes the quickest at level 4, I think, out of any jungler, because he can double prep camp, switch sides, and then power level 2 to level 4, but then he has to stick the gank.
Do you have a preference on how Ivern's played that side of the map or how they prioritize?
If there's no invades, I think you just go for level 4 clear, and it seems that the competitive plane have kind of settled to allow that. At the start, Ivern's were face shaking left and right, and it was more of a gamble. So I think it's going to be the standard clear, which is enchant the Wolf Camp, smite the blue, enchant the Gromp, move over, then enchant red and raptors, move back over, clear your camps, and then move up over to top side again. So that is kind of what Xerxes is gonna do here, path-wise. We could see an aggressive invade if Jankos, for example, goes smiteless into enemy red straight, but it's a very cocky play.
All right, well, keep our eyes on where Xerxes decides to go. A lot of early trading now in the bottom lane here between Nuclear and Shay.
Yeah, we're not going to delve into the mechanics because that's done far too often. TLDR of this bot lane is that Zyra and Ashe are going to be pushing and should be pushing all day. If you look at the mid lane, Syndra should be pushing Katarina. And early game, Maokai stays even towards Shen, but it doesn't really matter where they go. What matters is that HK has two pushing lanes with a causing jungle that usually leads to invades.
All right, leads to invades. We'll find out if Jankos can find any kills. Has consistently impacted the early game for such a long time now in the European LCS. Regardless of meta, regardless of champion, just seems to be in control.
Yeah, and the game is pretty stale until that Ivern goes for the level 3 or 4 gank. That needs to hit for Xerxes because his lanes are getting pushed in and under pressure against a team that is so used to playing the game properly, like H2K. It's obviously gonna result in advantages.
And Krepo, it's very early. It's only the second or third wave here, but like H2K really got lane control. Samix and Hilly, they were pushed completely back to their tower, and it goes back to this matchup.
Yeah.
Death Sentence finds Shay though, through the plant. Oh, it's gonna get traded backwards. Summoner heal used. And you can't get away with that one for Hilly.
Yeah, but see the flaws in Chase Baffing, that should never happen. Ever in that lane should you eat a hook as Zyra. But then again, Samux, he misses the point blank W, allowing Shay to survive. Shay would have died there if that hit.
Fortunately, it didn't, so nothing ventured or gained. So heal for Ignite. We caught a glimpse of Jankos going for the invade, but he didn't find any camps.
Jankos walked in because he can't deduce jungle pathing from leashes because Ivern doesn't need a leash. But based on which camps are down, Jankos should be able to predict that Ivern now is on the left side of the map, ganking either mid or top. So Fevervin needs to lean to the right side.
All right, information to work with. Exile trading heavily with Fevervin, jumps back in.
That's a great.
Trigger Seed's going to pop a little bit of a shield there, and here comes Jankos. He's just going to force Exile to jump backwards into the safety of the Brushmaker. So both junglers showing their faces and nothing really gained just yet.
Yeah, but they dodge a bullet here because look at Ivern's jungle. It's empty. Obviously, Jankos, he can always insta-clear camps. Ivern, he needs ramp-up time. He needs to enchant those camps and then return later unless he has Smite available. So there's a bit of a power trough here for this Ivern.
Yeah, definitely one of those sort of scaling champions. The longer the game goes, the more utility offers, the beefier that Daisy gets. But it's up to Jankos to sort of impact this early game. Has the champion to do so. Has a lot of CC to play with in really every single lane.
Yeah, and we saw the stats on the analyst desk, but this guy is topping the charts. Yes, his team is winning, but he's doing it by such a margin that is still impressive. He's definitely the best performing jungler right now in Europe. But one thing HTK need to watch out for is obviously that Shen ulti from Visichachi, Unicorns of Love. It was their fix in 2016 summer to kind of tied it all together. Once they were working on their macro, it allowed them to kind of jump from one lane to the other much faster, and it helped them kind of build up their macro game.
It really did. Talking about the top lane, Chachi, very early respect flash. Doesn't want to run the risk of getting jumped on and killed. But down in the bottom lane, Xerxes setting up, if not just for the camp, we'll see what sort of shenanigans he can get up to.
Now he's just simply counter-jungling right now. He knows Kha'Zix is on the top side. He doesn't really have too many camps in his jungle available. He can't get access to that gank here because Thresh had to base. Heelsang was outpoked. So I think the Unicorns, they're waiting for level 6 all in with the Shen ultimate.
And a lot of options to work with. Exile Shimpo's forward. He's going to get that preparation. Trigger Seed for the shield and flash blown by Fevervin. So both Jankos and Xerxes now successful sort of roaming flybys, blowing those summoner spells.
Yeah, but everybody playing with the necessary amount of respect, not watching if they could juke the skill shot. Insta flash is necessary. Nobody wants to be the guy that makes the first mistake.
Yeah, you never do. There's a charge. He teleports back to lane, got that Spirit Visage, Spectre's Cowl rather, working towards the Spirit Visage.
And even though every time we look, it seems like Exile's having good traits, he is down over 16, 17 CS at this point.
Do you think that's expected? I mean, in the matchup, in the early game?
I think it's defendable, but still, it just hints that you probably shouldn't pick Katarina. I'm so hesitant to call this a good pickup, especially in a comp where the only other real damage dealer is a low mobility carry that has to play versus Kha'Zix. Kha'Zix is so good, even versus Katarina in duels, because he has this temporary invisibility where Katarina's spinning daggers won't hit him anymore. And you can walk out, and she can't get the instant reset on you, or she can't pick up a dagger and Shampo immediately, and suddenly, you just isolate her and kill her.
If anyone's got the skill to do that, Jankos is the guy. You look at the European LCS. Up 10 CS on Xerxes, looking at gold. It's only about 200. Not a lot to speak home of, and Xerxes continues to prep those camps. So getting closer to ultimates and yeah. No huge advantages gained really outside that mid lane.
Yeah, just a small laning advantage here. Obviously, Samix and Huasang, they're waiting for the level 6, so they can get that Shen ultimate. Oh, I like this pathing from H2K. They really play around potential power spikes here on the map, because Unicorns, they're going to spike big with the Shen ulti, with the flash and the ignite up on Huasang. It almost guarantees a kill. So what H2K is saying, guys, we don't want to have that happen. Let's just split the map up. We go top lane. We were surprised the Shen without a flash. Maybe just straight up diving.
All right, so Nuclear and Shay heading up to the top lane. Samix and Hilly have yet to respond. I want to keep my eye on how Samix and Nuclear, how they continue to grow and develop, obviously with this favorable matchup in H2K and the supports, and now the lane swap.
We got to watch here, though. Is Fizzichachi aware that this is happening? The bot lane hasn't cleared yet, so he must know it's coming, but good interrupt.
Yeah, very good there. Shadow Dash taunts. Gets out of range. No grasping roots, so
and it was
down.
Called. It was called because the Unicorns of Love bot lane based walked back to lane, and it was like, these guys aren't back yet. Be careful, topside. That is a natural reaction right now. But they're late on the play. H2K is first on the rotation.
So good calling here from H2K. We heard some whispers coming into the splits about how Che might be taking over some of that shot calling duties, bringing in some of that experience from the LCK and his former teams. And we're going to have to ask them who's leading the charge. We know it's a very vocal team. Especially from the likes of Odo and Yenkos, of team comps gone by. But now we've just got sort of those Australia lanes.
Yeah, now it's all about vision control, especially in the river. Just allow your jungle to pass safely, predict enemy jungler's movements. There could be a case to be made here to just swap it up again, push out for action diary, because that is how you really translate an advantage in terms of push. You know you can't fight him in an all-in, but you have the minion wave control, so you just base. They have to push out. They're busy for 30 seconds. You can use that 30 seconds to make a better move, one that they may not expect, and that's exactly what H2K tried here.
And H2K as an organization have historically been very good when it comes to playing sort of the macro, the strategic level game.
And by H2K as an organization, you obviously mean Prowl.
He is part of the organization, so yes, indeed.
For the longest time, he was the only coach they had. They barely had any analysts, and he was definitely revolutionizing macro as a coach very early on. And he's been a consistent, important part of the org.
Yeah, helping out. All right, so some of the shenanigans have allowed Exile to catch up on CS here. 72 to 80. Mm-hmm. It was nearly 20 a few minutes ago. We're hitting 10 minutes into game time, and thanks to the sort of lane reassignment, I think Yankos has actually snuck into the pit. I didn't see if that control ward caught a glimpse of him.
You can tell they're not pinging on him, so it doesn't seem that they're aware of what he's doing. He probably even used a blast cone, because nobody's been in that area of the jungle for a while.
No, that control ward may have just missed it. So zero contest here from the Unicorns of Love.
Yeah.
First dragon of the game picked up by H2K.
And that's what you want to do, small advantages when the map's on lockdown, you can't find an opening, you're playing versus Shen ulti, and you have the scaling. Honestly, HK, they're comfortable taking this to late game, because they have 4 damage threats and a Maokai, whereas Unicorns of Love, they have 2 damage threats, and a Thresh that completely falls off in the late game.
Unless he finds that hook. Now, I'm being hyper-optimistic
But even
here.
In the late game, what are you going to do when you find a hook?
Yeah, get insta-gipped by Syndra, Kha'Zix, or Ashe.
Yeah, that historically has been the problem for a Thresh, because he essentially CCs himself while he's trying for a hook. On a good player, you have maybe 30% chance of hitting it, because he can either juke left, right, or stand still. And you're essentially playing at max range in the late game too, because there's so much zone control. You can't walk into a Zyra E range, you can't walk into Fevvin's Q E range, so you're playing max range Thresh, going for a low percent hook, and you CC yourself every time you throw it out. Which means you're just sitting bait.
Yeah, sitting target, shooting like fish in the barrel. Talking about that, the tower dive that H2K wanted to avoid is now being set up. Daisy has been called in. Stranglethorns to buy some time. Defensive flash. Exhaust onto Exile blocks the damage, and he takes the lantern to safety. Stun onto Xersei. First blood's available. Not picked up yet, but it is now. Feathervin locks it down. Odo, unfortunately, donates himself plus another to Exile. Over eager on the re-engage.
Yeah, we need to see what happened on the top side of that play. HK reacted in time. Odo Anima did get his chasing teleport off. This play nets teleport advantage for Unicorns though, so even if it would have backfired, they still have a net win. And they're looking for more.
Absolutely are. Nuclear and Che, they're very low. The flash hook catches Che. Samux closes the kill.
Yeah. That was Che trying to put up a plan for his AD carry with his flash down. And again, Unicorns, they're simply outplaying in the specific matchups.
Read the tower dive. H2K didn't respond quickly enough. And Krepa, you were praising how H2K had, you know, seen it much earlier in the game. But unfortunately, got caught a little bit out of position.
Yeah, you still got to play it right. Yankos and Odo going down there means a lot. Now Fevvin Oh, flash, but he should be okay.
Very close.
Just a wee bit short.
Chachiang not going to be able to find the taunt. And Chachi Stand United, there we go, paying dividends. We touched on sort of that Shen with Stand United and now teleport advantage. Surely there's a lot more pressure on Odo One there. He's got that Maokai. He's now got no teleport. And yeah, in you know, about a minute and a half time, Chachi's going to be able to just rinse and repeat.
So let's see what happened on the top side here. I like Exile jumping over the arrow. Honestly, really impressive. Arrow misses, he goes in, immediately jumps out because he gets exhausted into Yankos. Then Oduwame chases the Lantern, he is going down. 1v4, Maokai is still early in the game, but how does Yankos end up dying here? Instant distance from Katarina.
Yeah.
Good
hooks from Hylian. Here's that teleport from Chachi. Nuclear and Shay, no flash available. Nuclear locked down, death sentence as well. That's just CC for days.
Yeah, and Oduwame did exactly what he had to do. He was pushing the bot lane as hard as he can. There is the opportunity cost of that play for Unicorns where they leave their bot lane exposed. It is a single kill trade. All depends on who can get the first turret here. And actually, Oduwame is going to take it. So I think HCK is actually quite happy for this.
Okay, so net gold gain probably in favor of HCK because they also get the teleport cooldown as well. You have to factor
that in. Yeah, that's right, because they only made a mistake to give teleport advantage. Now Yankos is zoning Exile here, and they're kind of punishing for the Unicorns for playing too much on one lane. They all went topside to kill the AD carry, but HCK have shown in the past they're okay with their bot lane being slightly behind.
Well, they are indeed. Are HCK okay with getting jumped on in the mid lane? A lot of support for Unicorns of Love. Gonna push down. And Xerxes being really frustrating, throwing out that brush over and over. Really disruptive to a regular siege and a normal flow of gameplay.
Yeah,
all of a sudden losing vision.
You can pop that, it looks like a tiny brush. You can put Baron in that brush.
Uh-huh.
Which means even if you ward over the wall, you don't see what HP it is, so you get anxious and you jump in. Turns out it's on 8,000 HP and you die.
Baiting it in. Alright, tower equalized by Unicorns. It was Vizachachi that pushed that one in. 1-0-2 on the Shen, getting beefier. Teleport, gonna be quite a big disparity in time, but Stand United allows Vizachachi to jump in at any time.
It's always matched, so. And this is again the ward, the lingering ward right there. Not sure what the plant was for, it doesn't really help much. Nuclear is dead, anyways. They were too far up. You could argue that they shouldn't be playing that far up against the teleport, but there was a cross map advantage because Oduwame was instantly pushing the bot lane. That's what you have to do. Yeah, you gotta be ready. Know that if he teleports, we gotta take something back.
Got that tower first blood at the very least, but not a whole lot else. It's still an even game, right? It's 4 kills to 1. The problem is, it's Exile and Chachi that are starting to pull ahead. Chachi's very beefy. You take a look at some of his stats in comparison to Odo in terms of the matchup. And that could be pivotal. If Chachi Shen can keep Exile and Samux alive, I mean, he has to, because that's where the damage is coming from.
Yeah. Chachi needs to be in the game tankiness-wise, but the main onus to carry is still on Exile because he is one of the two damage dealers and he's the one that can actually produce most of the damage if he gets a reset, so it's even more important. You know, Sang using Vision to his advantage to maybe get a pick here. Unicorns now, they're moving into 1-3-1 kind of formation. Katarina on the side lane. She has good all-in, especially when she's ahead. So I like this. They're protecting Samux as well. Low mobility. Should be in the mid lane, in the middle of the game.
I like that style. We'll see how Hilly balances between backline with the Lantern and frontline for the hook. I said I wasn't going to say this at the beginning of the day, Crepo, but we've had 2 Ocean Drakes in a row. Mm-hmm. That's going to be the 11th Ocean Drake out of 69 Elemental Drakes.
It's a great movie. Don't watch the spin-offs, though. Goes downhill.
And the sustain's going to help by whoever can pick it up. But there's not really a huge amount of poke on either sides. No. They want to all in or they want to pick.
Very short time window poke.
Yes.
From Unicorns of Love.
Yes.
Still poke.
Definitely not the most powerful, Crepo. I'm taking a look at the vision around the map. And Unicorns very clearly setting their sights on Dragon.
Yeah.
It's not the deepest vision, though.
No, but it's enough because it allows Vizachachi to see what's going on. So when he needs to teleport, so there at least a 2 or 3 seconds buffer time on that teleport. They can place the dragon in the brush if it listens, but they can just do it right there as well.
Yeah, no real contest.
Zoning hook from Hillisang, classic.
We're going to see a lot of those, I feel.
My favorite.
As the game continues to progress. And Unicorns, they've gone toe-to-toe with HDK in the early game.
I'd rather walk down. I like this.
Okay, so teleport and Stand United will be available very shortly for Chachi. Tower should fall. It's so low.
Can't hide the tower.
No.
Can I dragon? Can I Baron? That structure, man.
They're immune to brush invisibility. And Crepo, H2K being run around the map a little bit. I mean, you know, they started that lane swap, then got punished for it.
Yeah, but it's still a nice move. When you're down 2 globals to 1 in the Shen versus Maokai matchup, what you can do, however, is push out the lane, keep the Shen busy, walk bot, or walk mid, hang on, Arrow.
Arrow Exile. Catches onto Exile, where Scatter the Weak, follow-up stun, unleashed power, exhausted, and the stand united.
That's good.
That's a worthwhile trade. 2 exhausts, though, both Febby and Exile threw that down.
Because it relieves the pressure, and even though Vizichachi has the teleport global, it means that Jankos can actually look for assassinations. It's the extra shield that makes it very annoying to play Kha'Zix into a Shen composition. So then they have a brief window, roughly, imagine something like 90 seconds. It's actually over 2 minutes still on rank 2. So they have about 2 minutes left to make a play, find a pick somewhere.
Both teleports are up, so at the very least it'll be equalized. It won't be able to be capitalized or optimized by Unicorns.
But it's more important that you can kind of one-shot the guy and then deal with whoever teleports in, have Oluwamna neutralize that, then rather have to burn through another like 400-500 HP shield.
This is going to become a war of attrition, where the UOL can balance their shields and their heals long enough to keep their 2 damage sources alive.
Exactly, and even on the map, it's kind of a summation of small map movements that kind of get you the advantage. It's not one big play, it's all set up, it's all kind of interwoven. You make one mistake, you lose your teleport. Okay, they're going to punish you, you need to play around that. Okay, you're pushing a lane, let's move to a different lane, put some pressure. Get some vision in, base, more wards, build on that same vision that you have already. That's what both teams are trying to do while counteracting what the other team is doing.
It's so difficult.
And then pressing all those buttons.
It's so difficult. Let's taking a look at the Plague Hams a moment ago. Jankos rattling off a mile a minute talking to the team. Chachi's got flash and dash available. Looking at the minimap, a little bit of encroaching H2K support, but he's not far enough to really be at risk of being killed.
Yeah, and I can't wait for the day that this matchup swaps, because then I sit away farther from Oduwamne, because that guy shouts. I'm having a hard time focusing on what I'm saying, because he's literally shouting so loud in terms of shot calling, that I'm trying to listen to what he's saying.
All right, Crepo, Nuclear's going to get caught out here. Chase steps forward to try body block the curtain call. Strangle Thorns at least knocks up Exile for now. And Che loses 75% of his HP, heal, and exhaust.
Yeah. But again, all the cooldowns are used. It's status quo right now.
Yeah. What's going to break this game open? Is it going to be a mistake or an outplay that sets it up? Or like,
I think scaling is going to put it up. I think HK is just comfortable playing it slow. Eventually, this Jhin is going to be threatened by Zyra all in. Late game, a Zyra can one-shot Jhin. Just flash EQR, he's dead. Ash can peel for herself a little bit with Arrow. Syndra can always play that. Press the high IQ button. Like, I mean, same player, by the way. Press R. And then Kha'Zix scales as well, whereas Unicorns, they funnel everything into utility. Shields, Shen ultimate to keep somebody alive, but if they get picked off and make one mistake, it's over.
I was gonna say, like, the margin for error on the Unicorns team composition feels lower than on H2K. Grasping Roots goes out, trying to chunk down Daisy as best as possible.
All right, Shen's basing. You should always be careful when you see a Shen base on the minimap, because they could always be looking for something. Whoever loses mid lane turret in these kind of matchups generally gets behind, but Unicorns of Love have been putting so much pressure that it's been dangerous for H2K to push out their side lanes. And I love this usage of the brush here to hide the Thresh.
Very clever. Exile very optimistic with that Death Lotus. Not really going to find a lot of damage onto Jankos. He instantly leaps away.
And look at how comfortable they are. They're peeling away Feverman to play on side lanes. This is, if you go back all the way to Spring last year, when they subbed in Selfie over Ryu, they weren't doing this. They were playing very Aram-esque in the mid lane, just 4 people right there. But right now, it does seem that they're confident in relying, letting Shay and Nuclear clear out the mid wave. So simply move to a side lane, push it out a bit, and come back. And that's good to see from HK.
I want to talk a little bit more about Nuclear and Che, because they had that sort of favorable support matchup. Nuclear on the ADC down 30 CS. Mm-hmm. And these are two guys who have struggled a little bit in the games we've seen. We'll expand on that in a moment, because Chachi could get jumped on, but it feels like the tower will be the focus here.
Oh yeah, it's all about the implication. Yeah. You just walk up, it's like, yeah, we could fight you, could waste some time here, but we're actually here for the turret.
And what's your take on Nuclear and Che now? They've got a very sort of utility-heavy duo.
I mean, it's really harsh to base it on a few moments, but if you get hooked level 2 as Zyra, you're not playing the game right. Right now, H2K getting punished for that rotation top as well, losing their mid lane turret. Not really worth it in my books. Because this will allow Unicorns to put that same pressure mid, but now much deeper, and then they can pivot into either left side or right side jungle, and once they deny some vision, that's when they truly want to make some picks here. Like Hillisang hiding in a brush, into Hook, into Katarina. That's what they're looking for.
Find out if HCK get caught out. It's 22 minutes in, three towers to two. It's only a 1,000 gold game in favor of H2K, but the game has been defined. H2K make a play, UOL respond and get something either to equalize or more.
Yeah, equalize or more, definitely to say that. Sheepy, so intensely staring. Roma, staring as intensely as you can with a fluffy unicorn hat.
At least he didn't flinch.
Oh, he's got the stare unlocked.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Jolsa has abs of steel.
The thing is, this game is currently balancing on a knife edge. There's no super clear advantage.
Ooh,
Hilly was chasing forward. That's the death sentence! Signaling it for Febby. He's able to flash away. Manages to get the ultimate off, but it was exhausted. Exile still alive. Looks to be jumped on here by Odo. Shut down by Odo Wamne. Nuclear caught by a death sentence once more. Flash for Chachi. He's under the tower. He's not rooted, but it's Yankos that sinks the fangs in. Tastes the fear and forces him away. And two for two.
The only damage that remains is Samurks, which is not very much. So Odo Wamne can already peel that front line, and that's exactly what is going to happen in the late game. If Exile drops without removing at least two people from HK's lineup, they will still lose the fight, because you cannot trade damage dealers equally, because H2K has four, Unicorns have only two.
Mountain Dragon, the next target. Unicorn backing away from this. Not going to contest. It doesn't feel like H2K are going to pick it up. It ends up being a two for two, but it was H2K that peeled it back after being engaged. And after, really, I mean, Febbervin was just run down.
Yeah, it was run down, but he also had a moment to flash at one point. He flashed after taking damage, instead of just flashing the Jin W. It was a good setup from Unicorn. Poking to Jin W is a really good way to make picks, but it's also flashable. Let's watch this again. So, at this point, Febbin has flash. He sees the particle come out. I think you just flash slightly in an angle, so you dodge the Jin bullet, and then you survive. So, Exile drops really low here, because Febbin still gets his ulti off. Shay's trying to pick him up, so Exile kind of jumps back into Odo Wamne, and at this point, look, the fight looks so good for Unicorns, but everything slows down. Visit Chachi barely has any base damages to take down Nuclear, but he trades a kill onto Yankos. Now Yankos has damage, Shay has damage. Technically, the Zyra over the wall can still damage, so they need to peel back.
Yeah, peel back, that's what you all do. Concede another Dragon. Two kills for two. Dragon to H2K, and it's a juicy one, and help them on all those objectives.
And you're going to see this a lot this game. Hillisang and Samurks waiting in a brush, kind of hoping that H2K is not quite paying attention.
It's appropriate that it's the candy Ivern skin. And get some s'mores, pitch a campsite, you know, get a little bonfire going and just wait for somebody to run into your hook. Because actually, if you look outside of that, UOL's engage is entirely reliant on a Samurks sort of slowdown ulti from range.
Yes and no. I mean, there's always teleport flying from Shen. Taunt Flash used to be the greatest engage tool in League of Legends. I think it's all just position reliant. Problem is they need vision denial, so they need to group up for pressure, then deny vision, and then push out again. But that's hard, because the second they group up, their silence are going to get pushed, which put pressure on them again. Yeah. So it's a really hard balance to find. And HK, by all means, need to keep pushing out these silence if they want to keep the Unicorns down. But I feel like we've been talking too much from the HK perspective. So maybe shift it around a little bit more, think about what Unicorns want to do next. And I think it's just enable Exile.
Enable Exile, find some CC onto an H2K member, allow him to get further hit. I mean, he's 3-1-1, Abyssal Scepter, Gunblade completed. If they needed him to have damage, he's got a fair amount of it right now. Defensive Samurks. Flash from Samurks, stands United Shield, not going to be enough. And all of a sudden, it's H2K that find the pick. Odo from the side and just obliterates him.
Yeah, the Unicorns were looking to deal with one of these side lane pushes that we talked about earlier. The second they leave, their AD carry walks up, but he doesn't really respect the engage potential from this HK lineup.
Does not indeed. Teleport comes down from Visit Chachi. Daisy's been removed from the map. 5-on-4 for another 15 seconds, and H2K, they've run out of minions to work with.
Yeah, one more minion wave. This is the last try. They juke the hook. Very obviously, they'll come out on the wave, and they're looking to put more damage here. All eyes are on Exile.
All right, so keep an eye on plays he can make, if at all. No damage to come down. The tower is secured. Exile's gonna Shimpo forward. Trigger Seed, Flash, Hook, onto Nuclear. Follows it through. That's a gig play. Not gonna be enough. Stranglethorns knocks up two. Exile's down to 30%. Samurks has got a reply. So far it's a two for two. The fourth shot from the curtain call doesn't do enough. Xersei and Samurks, they continue to chase down. But there's a lot of damage from Fabian Jankos still.
Yeah, we're looking at some of the weaknesses from Katarina in the current metagame, where two people bring exhaust each fight, both pop it, and there is a wealth of cancels available on Oluwamne as well on that Maokai, so we can still question that Katarina, because that was the ideal scenario. You flash in with a hook, everybody parts like the Red Sea to let Nuclear get hooked right there. Shay did not decide to take it for him. And there's only two kills that the Unicorns can get from that.
And both Nuclear and Jay had their flashes. Let's see if it was available in the fight. We'll check that out in the replay in a moment.
Yeah, but look, poor guys. Like, anybody block it? I have a tank, Maokai. Yeah,
both of them are on cooldown.
Yep. I think Oluwamne made a mistake position here. I think you should always protect your AD carry and just walk in front of him so you can take the hook and turn the fight around. And even then, Exile, he gets exhausted through all the damage. Jankos avoids most of it, and they can just soak it up.
H2K were at least able to get the tower. They trade evenly in kills. They're still ahead in gold. Technically, they're still in control of the game. It's not a big margin. It's not a big lead.
Yeah, but they have the scaling advantage.
Yeah.
3,000 is irrelevant when it comes to scaling comps. They could be 2,000 gold behind right now, and they would still be in control of the game, in my opinion.
Krepa, before that whole fight broke out, we wanted to look at sort of the UOL perspective a little. And I want to step back and say, right, the UL picks and bans, they didn't go for MF, they went for the Thresh, you know, they sort of opted into this team comp. From what you've seen from their macro and their mid to late game decision making, is this similar to what we've seen in their previous series?
It's hard to tell because it's very dictated by the draw.
Okay.
If you look at a glance and say, okay, they picked Thresh, and Hillsang is 0-1-8, the first reaction you're gonna have is like, oh, he's doing fine. Like, why are you whining? Why are you complaining? But what you could maybe look at is, imagine a world where this was an MF support. Hang on, imagine a world where Exile doesn't die.
Well, we're gonna have to wait a second longer. Flash and Shunpo gets him to safety.
Just a little bit more on a hypothetical. You have an MF support that can then push in the Zyra and the Ashe, which means Katarina can actually roam bot with the dive with Shen ulti, and that's how you snowball. You get the Katarina fed. Your lanes should be in service of the Katarina if you decide to pick her. And that's not really what happened. The lanes were in service of themselves. Yeah. I think it was a comfort pick coming out for Hillsang over, I think, the better meta pick for the Unicorns.
Let's find out if he can find the pick, you know, find that death sentence.
I'm just afraid, even if he does,
what happens?
Yeah. Is it too late?
Yeah, I mean, with 30 minutes into the game, we're you know, kicking off late game. 2-3 items completed across the board, mostly. Voidstaff, Abyssal, Morella, Nomicon for Febby. The high IQ button is becoming even smarter.
Syndrome, man, level 16, she's still smart. You can throw a Q behind you, throw it left or right, you don't care. Pop another Q, press R, and you're the most gifted player in the world.
Hey, it's gonna make me scream and jump, that's for sure. And Chachi and Oluwamne are also gonna be the most sort of pivotal ones when these fights break out. Chachi with a good taunt, Odo with a good ulti, and like if he can block some of their skill shots.
Yeah, well, Fizzy Chachi has the ability to set up for Exile to eliminate any carry in under a second. It's up to Oluwamne to prevent that from happening.
Death sentence catches him in. Hilly is the target. Stand United's already been used. Everything thrown in the mid lane. Exile's already killed Shay. Still alive. Exhaust burning him down. He flashes and dashes away, but gets taken down. Daisy and Odo, they're traded back and forth. Chachi gets a good taunt onto Nuclear. Flashing. H2K and UL, they've swapped sides. H2K retreating to the red side. Odo's looking to shut down Hilly, the man who started the fight. It's a 2-for-3 in favor of UOL.
Yeah, Jankos is still alive, looking for some damage on the flank. It's gonna be a slow one, but Oluwamne should go down. One Maokai, three guys, and a Daisy. That's not gonna be enough.
Not enough at all, but he survives for so long. 4 kills to Unicorns, and they turn for Baron.
And if something you could say about the Unicorns is that they're decisive. When they go in hard with zero hesitation, no matter what the outcome. Now it's up to Jankos to peel, and we talked about this earlier. Once that Baron starts hiding in the brush, if it's placed properly, unless they changed that, I don't think they did.
No, we saw it yesterday, actually, blinding it up. But a defensive flash from Jankos. Smites are available.
It got so slow.
4 shots and a reload. Samux, Jin, not the greatest Baron killer.
It's like, guys, we're playing this intensive match versus H2K. We want to fight. We finally did it. Let's see how this goes. So this is the weakness of Thresh. You go for a hook. Or he's about to go for a hook. He stands still, so he eats an Ash Arrow. But even then, so many people would flash out. Hillsang's like, nope, I'm going in. And he peels for Exile because he eats all the cooldowns. This is a mistake, in my opinion, from Oluwamne. Why would you go on Hillsang instead of Exile? And I think that turned the fight for Unicorns. They did everything right, I think. They tried their best, but if Oluwamne lands Twisted Advance on Exile right there, chases him after, and Fevervin literally just presses R, I think HK still win this fight.
But they didn't, and I meant Exile got the kill, got a lot of damage, was still a threat.
But it shows you, even when they kind of luck out or they rely on a misplay from their opponents, and even when they still win a fight, they can't capitalize, because the second they lose one of their damage dealers, it's so hard for them to get that objective that they need to win, which is the Baron.
Well, that means the Unicorns of Love, they've at least closed that gold gap. Look at the damage dealt in the team fight. Yeah. Obviously, in a 2-for-4 trade, you are going to come out tops. They're fairly impressed. Samuk's not, you know, playing safe, playing in the back line.
No, he's
what
doing,
he needs to do.
He's doing above what is expected. Samuk, we came in and we honestly questioned the pickup. On a very late notice, obviously, for the Unicorns, we have to defend that. They didn't have the chance to shop around for all AD carries in the offseason. They integrated him well. He seems to really bond to the Unicorns of Love's culture. And he is performing in this game, 3-1-7, against plenty of carries and abilities that could pick him off.
I think it's important to know, like, not only this game, but throughout the four that he's played, 4-4-13 on his Caitlyn stats, 11-1-14 on his Jhin performances leading up to this. I've been pleasantly surprised by a lot of the UOL players. You know, Xerxy also slotted into the squad, has made, honestly, a hell of a statement. Not playing any of the meta junglers.
But such a slow game for him on this Ivern. I love seeing Xerxy on junglers that accelerate and have a chance to make the outplay. Right now, I feel he's being reduced to a former, or a lesser form of himself, rather. With a side lane tussle of the remaining turrets.
Yep.
Doesn't really matter in the grand scheme of things. We need to see what happens around that Nashor right now. Side lanes, where they're positioned in terms of push, is important. And then the vision on Baron, because it's all going to boil down to that one.
And who can control those waves more effectively? Chachi with Standardite and Teleport has an early advantage. Also a Tiamat, going to start picking up some of that damage. We're looking at the minimap, Krepo. H2K have to respond because they're being pushed both bottom and top.
Yeah, actually they just did. So they just pushed out the top lane. It's neutralized right now. But that's why Fevervin's doing well. He's always just peeling off and at least making that lane neutral, just allowing some vision in the top side. Bottom is under pressure though, because Vizicacci is having a great game here. Having the push advantage overall around the currently.
And has used that Stand United very defensively, obviously. Mm-hmm. But hasn't really looked for those proactive Stand United, maybe with a Death Sentence or a Xerxy.
Yeah, because it's all conditional engage, right?
Yeah.
If you gotta buffer Stand United, believing that your Thresh is gonna land a flash hook, then you have some confidence.
Well, I mean, if you're gonna pick Thresh over MF, I think you have to have some confidence anyway, right?
Yeah.
There is a little bit of that.
You gotta believe.
Yeah, gotta believe in the power of the skill shots. Unicorns have dragged this game to 35 minutes. They've evened out the gold. If the scaling and the champion composition is still in favor of H2K, as maybe they start leaning towards some MR or start looking to survive that burst from Exile, like, surely the options become more and more limited for UOL.
It becomes the same option. The likelihood of it happening is going to be reduced.
Okay, I like that.
I mean, this is literally semantics, but it's still a Fisher hook. Get all in, boys. If they die, we win. If we get two resets, we win. If not, it's a little over. As opposed to H2K, they're just looking to not make a mistake. I think they're just so comfortable scaling. Oluwamne knows his role in teamfights. It's a disruptor. He just has to find Exile or Samex.
Not Nuclear.
Yeah, Nuclear's playing utility. He goes for an early QSS. He just wants to survive any snare or root that can make him a reset target.
This is the upgrade of the Death Bush. Build a bush, and then wait for it.
And it's annoying, because it's so obvious. Like, of course they're in that brush, but maybe they're in the other one.
Yeah.
Maybe they're in an actual brush. Where are they?
Nope. Do not want to answer that question.
Maybe it's Maybelline.
Che, gonna throw down some plants. Holds onto the control ward for a few seconds longer. For Exile and Hilly, double team to take it down. Taking a look. All summoner spells are available. Yep. Baron is up. Next dragon is Elder in about 5.5 minutes. GA for Odo. I mean, it's going to be set up to like one monumental fight and then potentially the game is over.
And it's all an Exile. He has to maybe even wait before going in because he's getting insta-exhausted, which means he's being buffered. Which basically means the support and the Fevervin, they're clicking exhaust on Exile already before he's even in the fight, hoping that he'll jump in and the game will insta-trigger it for you. But if you can abuse that, The characters will start walking towards Che is caught,
so is Hilly. Support taking a lot of damage. Yankos jumps in. Stranglethorns knocks him up. Hilly stays alive for a few seconds longer. Exile's been exhaust, spinning and not winning. Death Lotus doesn't find a kill, but the Shunpo does. Exile's rooted down. Shunpo's over. Ash Arrow locks him out. That's a triple. Exile's looking for the Quadra. Not going to find it just yet. A few seconds longer. Nuclear running for his life. He's shut down. H2K lose 4, and Odo will get cut down in just a matter of time.
Run, Hillisang!
Hillisang! It's the Meowkai not gonna make it. Guardian Angel, the base is now gonna fall apart. Exile survives, Krempo.
Yeah, he survives, and not only that, he tears H2K rather apart. Now Hillisang has to run from this for his life from that sapling, but the base is dying here.
Ooh.
And that's all on a single decision from H2K to turn there, by the way.
All of the time, though, they didn't get inhib. 10 seconds for the rest of H2K, and they're killing for Baron.
Asher, that's exactly what they're looking for here. It finally pays off, and they punish H2K who go in. H2K had all the chances to reset that fight completely, waste Stand United, go back to the status quo, but they believed that they could get the one shot, prevent the Shen from landing, and that would have won them the fight. So this was literally a 200 HP difference, win or loss, HGK or Unicorns of Love. Watch this again. So the hook goes wide, so they know one CC is down already. Che gets rooted, Hillisang gets punished, and Yanko's here. He goes in for the kill. But look at that shield at the very end that keeps Hillisang alive. And now Exile is looking for the reset. Yanko's is too low. Just one shot. If Evan, he walks up too close. Disengage should be the motto here. Beautiful plays by Exile, though. Really mastering those resets and weaving his flash in between.
Febby never even got a chance to use that exhaust. The first one is burned through.
So what we're talking about, like, it's you gotta buffer him, because when he's jumping around that quickly, you simply can't drag your mouse around to where he is. It's really hard to exhaust a Katarina in the middle of the fight. So that's why you gotta wait as a Katarina before you jump in, so you prevent people from buffering exhaust on you.
So tough, so tough. One Shunpo, one exhaust. Probably the longest kill you're going to see in Spring Split. But more importantly...
And it's this that they need to leverage. Odoamne being able to keep Exile busy, that's the advantage that HK is looking for.
Over 6,000 damage in favor of Exile. And if he can do that, that's how UOL win. Now, to be fair, Unicorns now have an extra lever to turn. They can try play the split push game.
They have more time to look for hooks, especially. Because when you walk up with a buff minion wave like this, it's simply not just insta one-shotable, which means you can fish for Ivern Snares like he's doing right there. One of them lands, you have follow-up for a hook, and then you can play the waiting game. Every wave now takes about 10 seconds to clear.
Oh, so scary for H2K. Teleport not available for Odo. He's backing away from that top lane, and Chachi is trying to usher the middle lane in. So we're looking for a death sentence or a trigger seed here from Xersei or Hillisang.
All pressure from the Shen on the mid lane inhib, allowing or forcing HGK to send one or two members back to deal with that. Odoam is actually not going to go for it. He's going for the instant engage. H2K want to turn this one around.
All right, Daisy's already been used, picked up by the Force of Will. Curtain Call as well for zoning. So two ultimates to unlock a tower and potentially an inhibitor.
Fevin got hit somehow. So before Odoam could kind of get that flanking motion, things were already happening there, so we don't know.
Oh, big shot there from Samax onto the tower. Exile dashes in, Shunpo's out. Gets onto the ladder, and despite Che being rooted, there's no follow-up. Visit Chachi doing a good job with that Titanic Hydra. Inhib's in trouble, and now the bottom tower's in trouble.
And now it falls apart, but now there's pressure on two lanes. Before, it was only Visit Chachi really winning that side lane control over Odoamne.
Oh, not really the target you want. Odo's gonna dodge away with a Twisted Advance. Inhibitor's gonna fall in just a few moments as the tower does down bottom.
They will funnel into the base, however, on the side of Unicorns, and there's plenty of catch here with Fevern's QE combo, Nuclear's Arrow, and Shea having Flash very soon. Unicorns still have to be very careful, because when Exile gets double exhausted, he may not have enough damage.
Odoamne's looking for a target. Sapling toss running towards towards the minion line. Unicorns at 41 minutes, they're inside the base. Daisy gets pulled up once again. Where's the Ash Arrow? Looking for Nuclear to start. Daisy gets pulled backwards. A lot of damage onto Xercy. Odo Omnes is in the front line. Samux gets caught out. He manages to walk away from now. Nobody's down just yet. Follow Exile. He's on the right-hand side of the fight. Jumps back in. Dashes for the Shunpo. Got the first. Febby is slowed. Taunted. Killed. Death sentence onto Che. And the curtain is called. Inhibitor follows next.
Yeah, Unicorns of Love with impressive patience right there. They just simply wait with jumping in and they kill Odo Amle first, and once the tank is down, then the reset screen happens.
Death sentence onto Nuclear, even in the base. The Unicorns of Love, Baron empowered minions. They take down the Nexus turrets. They look onto the base. Hilly's not done yet. Follows the death sentence. Gets shut down. But it's simply for show. The rest of Unicorns continue the chase and the fight. Slowly, slowly, the Nexus goes down and exiles Katarina. Goes 1-0.
The Unicorns end up taking a game with more tension than action. They still pull through. What I like the most is just how decisive they are in these key fights. They go all out when it matters, especially Heelsang twice, and it just shows, even with the Thresh, even if you miss the hook or you kind of get engaged on, he just goes aggressively. He is basically a cooldown absorber and a Shen delivery system. Once his job's done, he was fine dying and helped his team.
All of the risk was on the UOL side to find a team fight where Exile could pop off, get through the exhausts or make them not relevant. They found that one fight. I mean, it opened up the game. Anyways, we're going to head to the analyst desk to take a closer look at how the Unicorns won game one over G2.
Over G2.
It wasn't G2, it was H2K. that wasn't Trevor's fault. We're going to take a look at exactly the risks that you guys were talking about as it dominated the entire game. And it's also the first thing that came to your minds. The Unicorns of Love are taking risks in the draft. To you guys, was it just a Katarina, or was it also the Thresh, also maybe the Ivern as a first pick for them?
I mean, all of them are kind of risky in a sense where, like, I think the Syrah Ash lane should dominate the Thresh Jhin lane so hard. And then on top of this, like, Katarina needs to play aggressive in the mid lane to win the matchup. And you're playing against the Kha'Zix that should win against Ivern. So a lot of it is on H2K not punishing UL's draft early.
Yeah, I mean, I have to echo the sentiment from Trashy, simply because when we saw this draft coming too, we thought, okay, I mean, like, the Ivern might not be that bad. Going for the Shen, it's not that bad. And then the Insta-Lock Katarina, we're just like, it was definitely a risk, and you could see a lot of risks being taken. But it seems that UOL understood very well what they needed to do with their draft, and they managed to get through what could have been a very dangerous early game into a very promising game.
Yeah, and as you said, Trashy, you can't let Jankos go off in that situation. They didn't let Jankos go off. You can't have a big deficit in either of the lanes. And even though it was hard in mid lane, they didn't have a huge deficit. And on top of that, the top lane fight happens that gives Unicorns of Love two kills on their mid. And let's take a look at how that happened and who could have avoided what here.
I mean, I think that, like, for the start, I think it's good that Yoas is forcing it. But I think the big thing here is that Odo is committing into four people alone and there's not really any follow-up. And then Jankos is kind of getting hit by the hook as well. So it was two free kills for Katarina. And the only thing that can't happen for H2K this game is that Katarina gets fed, and that kind of happens. So it's a bit unlucky for H2K.
A bit of an oopsie, that's for sure. But also, like, this also stems into some criticism that we both had for the bottom lane of H2K, because one of the things we talked about at the top of the show was, how is the bottom lane of H2K going to stack up against that of Unicorns? And both Thresh and I thought, well, I mean, it shouldn't be that bad. The difference shouldn't be that big. But we definitely saw quite a big difference between the two.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of props to Hyllisang and Samux for actually getting CS lead in this lane. I don't think that ever should happen. And on top of this, I think that Sex and Exile played very well around mid in the game. So a lot of props to them. I didn't expect them to play this well, honestly, from watching their previous games this split. So I'm impressed.
And definitely the bottom lane as a whole, but maybe Hyllisang, as you mentioned, on that Thresh, you said a Thresh shouldn't work. We heard in the cast as well. Actually, it shouldn't work later into the game. There's so many stuns. There's so many ways for him to get targeted, but he does get the hook off every single time.
Yeah, I mean, our next replay looks a little bit at this, where you do see that the Thresh... this is how you can set up fights, but the big risk that you see is the double teleport. And even though the Katarina got the initial snowball off, when you have exhaust after exhaust coming down onto a Katarina, it becomes very difficult. And we were looking at how H2K wanted to play this game, and they had a very promising teamfight composition. And in situations like that is ideally what they wanted to happen.
Yeah, and I think actually you all misplayed a bit in the mid game. I think they could have put Katarina on side lane and played it like that. Instead, they're just grouping for mid all the time. So definitely you all could have played it better in the mid game. But yeah, I think they closed out the game, so they played well.
Yeah,
they definitely did, especially when you look at the few later stage fights, because Katarina definitely was allowed to go off in a few of these fights later on into the game. Because the great thing about Kat is if she's not the focus, then she has a lot more freedom. And this is where Exile really is allowed to shine, because you can just see his positioning. The moment he jumps in here, he gets exhausted, but that's fine because he hasn't used a lot of his damage yet. And he can reposition in a way that enables him to get the reset and just chunk out one of the key targets like Feather. So
this is the point in the solo queue game where everyone is like, why is Katarina open? So yeah.
And you were also mentioning the fact that Ivern in this point in the game where he is nearly full build and he's a second support and he can offer so much in a team fight makes it extra difficult for H2K.
Yeah, like Ivern at this point is pretty much just like probably the best supportive champ in the game because he brings so much to the table. Like he has so many shields, so many items that brings sustain to the fight, and if Katarina doesn't die in the fight, then they will just roll over them.
I mean, we saw it at the very beginning of that fight where Hillisang, he's the one that actually gets caught up and he gets a Shen shield, he gets Locket, he gets Redemption, he gets the Ivern shield, and he still doesn't die at the end
no.
of that. So, I mean, you just see the potency of this Ivern pick later on.
So, is the deficit of H2K in the bot lane big enough to net UOL the win in the next game as well and net them the series?
It had a big impact for sure, but the biggest reason was that they didn't actually punish you all for taking risk in the draft in the early game. And then if you don't punish that, then the draft is solid. So that was the biggest problem.
So it's still all open.
Yeah, I still think that H2K can easily claw this one back. I think that perhaps Jankos is just warming up. I'd like to see a little bit more from him in the early game. But definitely Unicorns of Love, not a team to be underestimated.
I think for next game, we will see if H2K stay on blue side, we will see Ivern ban, and then we will see Sax going maybe for the Rumble or Sek or something like this. And then I think it should be better for H2K.
They are on blue side, so we'll see if that comes through
then
in the next game.
I think we can predict Ivern.
All right, well, coming up after the break is that game 2 between Unicorns of Love and H2K. Stay tuned.